Previously on Junior President.
Congratulations, ladies and gentlemen. Congratulations. Okay, so six young ladies, six young gentlemen vying for the junior presidency. So out of all that auditioned, you guys have finally made it to the contest. Congratulations. Coming up in your lives are tough moments. It's not going to be an easy competition. From different backgrounds, you've come to make friends out of this competition and hopefully wish you nothing short of the very best. So now we're going to give you your first assignments in the competition, and you're going to have a mock AU summit, like the actual AU summit. The only difference is it's going to be done by 12 young junior presidents representing 12 different countries. And the subject you're going to speak on, the subject you're going to speak about affects each and every person living on the African continent. It's a subject of unemployment coupled with entrepreneurship right here on the African continent. The theme of your AU summit to be held at the Mulungushi International Conference Center, ladies and gentlemen, is entrepreneurship, a substitute for unemployment in Africa. Is it a good theme? I'm glad you guys like it. So each and every one of you will be given one country to represent. You represent that country as its head of state, not as a Zambian, but you represent that particular country that's going to be assigned to each and every one of you. So, I've got Esther Mwansamulenga. Esther, you are going to represent Botswana, Zambia's neighbor. Blue is their color, and we do wish you all the best as you prepare for that assignment. And then we also have Wantula Simbaya. Wantula, congratulations for making it. You will be representing Tanzania, another one of Zambia's neighbors. We wish you all the best as you represent that country. And then I have John Piri. John Piri, congratulations to you as well. In our AU summit, you will be representing Ghana. Ghana is a country that you will be representing as head of state. And then also we do have the young lady, Christine. Christine, you will be representing South Africa. Congratulations. We wish you all the best as you represent that country. And we also have Kunda Mutwakunda. You'll be representing Zambia's neighbor on the east, and that is Malawi, at our coming AU summit. Natasha Mwansa, congratulations for making it. You will be representing Nigeria, Africa's most populous country. They are the ones that you will represent at the mock AU summit. And Perry Kentinkole, congratulations. I like the black outfit, you know, the black and white. Congratulations to you for making it to the final 12. You will be representing Kenya. You will be representing Kenya at the mock AU summit. And Mwiza Zulu, congratulations, Mwiza. You'll be representing Namibia at our AU summit. Congratulations to you. And I also have the lovely Ali Nani Nakazwe. Ali Nani, congratulations. You will be representing Uganda, far from Zambia, but I know that technology and information is going to help you do your job well. And we also have Mr. Joseph Mulenga. Congratulations, Mr. President. You will be representing, in this particular contest, you will be representing Zimbabwe. Mr. Wantula. Ah, not Wantula, Mputa Ngalande. Congratulations, Mputa. How's your mother? Ah, I'm happy to know she's fine. You will be representing Mozambique, another one of Zambia's neighbors. All the best as you represent that country. Last but not the least, Farai Kajemoto. Congratulations, Farai. Daddy's okay? Okay, good to know that. You will be representing the Democratic Republic of Congo. So there you have it. These 12 countries are the ones that you guys will be representing, and we do hope that you do your jobs well. At the end of the summit, we're going to nominate three people, and at the end of it, someone must leave the competition. We wish you guys nothing but the very best as you take on this assignment, and at the end of it, we're looking for just one winner. And this assignment is the beginning of many more wonderful assignments coming in the future. We'll see you guys at the Mulungushi International Conference Center. Wish you the best as you prepare for this assignment. All the best, ladies and gentlemen. You can go back as you prepare for your assignments. Okay, so there you have it, our final junior presidents take leave as they prepare for the mock AU summit. Remember that this summit is the beginning of many assignments to come on junior president. At the end of the summit, three of them must get nominated, and ultimately someone has to leave the contest. The question is, will they do the best of their abilities, or maybe something else is going to come up? We do not know, but the one thing we know for sure is that irregardless of their backgrounds, each and every one of these junior presidents is giving this competition nothing but the very best. We hope that each and every one of them will get the support that they need. But for now, let's take a short break, and then after that, we will be coming to you with that assignment given to our 12 junior presidents right here on the Zambia National Broadcasting Corporation's channels.
This is the perfect time. Been dying to hear from you. I hope that this moment lasts, 'cause it feels so true. Maybe I'm out of my mind, but I know that your love's hard to find.
When we love someone, we become selfless, devoted, and we accept the one we love wholeheartedly. But the question we often ask ourselves is, how far would you go for the one you love? How far would you go to connect their heart to yours every day? Zamtel. Live life today.
Okay, so thank you so much to the junior president representing the Republic of Tanzania. We are now three speakers away, and our next speaker is representing Africa's most populous nation. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the junior president from Nigeria. Okay, so junior president Natasha Mwansa makes her way to the podium. She is the 10th speaker of the summit.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chairperson, all protocols be highly observed. My country, Nigeria, consists of about 179 million inhabitants. It is considered as the giant of Africa with a GDP worth more than $500 billion. Either way, it still faces a challenge just as any other developing country in Africa, the challenge of unemployment. It is for this reason that me and my government have decided to take entrepreneurship and try by all means to use it as a substitute for unemployment. Entrepreneurship has so many definitions. For others, it is just starting up a business, and for others, it is the journey and exploration and risk management to create value or profit or for social good. Entrepreneurship has proven very useful to a country's developmental growth. It has been claimed as a major driver of economic growth. It raises the standard of living of people in a country in ways and can also provide employment. It is for this reason that me and my government have taken entrepreneurship into consideration. We have come up in Nigeria, you find that there are over 98% of SMEs, small and medium enterprises, which have taken the role of entrepreneurship. SMEs have played and continue to play significant roles in the growth, development, and industrialization of many economies world over. In our country, SMEs face so many challenges, and the local people have also faced these challenges in SMEs. And it is for this reason that SMEs have not yet proven their worth to our country, but soon will. Me and my government have got plans. By all means, me and my government are going to support SMEs. Me and my government have carried out some research, and in comparison to Sweden, our country has been proven that the educational system for entrepreneurship has been less than in Sweden. In Sweden, where some of the entrepreneurs were interviewed and have proven that their education was higher and they had a good education before they became entrepreneurs. While when our entrepreneurs in Nigeria were asked, they actually did not have much of educational background, and this has proven to be very risky, because in this way they do not know how to manage the entrepreneurship skills that they have. Our country has got 179 million inhabitants, and less than 40% of these inhabitants are unemployed, and half of these 40% are youth, which is between the age of 15 to 35, and half of these youths, which is 56% of youth are unemployed. And for these challenges, this is the challenge that entrepreneurship is facing. Entrepreneurship has faced a lot of challenges because of the terrorism of Boko Haram. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the reason why me and my government have carried out projects to talk to other countries that are actually promoting this and to try and cause peace. We have decided to go to Saudi Arabia and ask them to stop supporting the dictators who fund terrorists. In doing so, we stop arming the terrorists, and we also have decided to stop mass surveillance in our country, to stop torture, and to stop drone assassinations of innocent civilians. And in this way, we are asking for your support as other nations. My country has got plans to improve entrepreneurship. It is going to try by all means to use our oil as our main export, to use it and as a raw material and turn it into a finished good. In doing so, we're actually supporting exports than imports, because one of the things that are affecting SMEs in our country is too much of importation. Our government has also put in laws that whereby they will reduce imports and more exportation. In doing so, we are circulating the money in our country, and also we are improving our marketing advertisement. We are also going to reduce rates, and we are going to use agriculture to our advantage. Agriculture has played a major part in Nigeria, and therefore we are going to try by all means to use agriculture. We are also going to encourage local products and patriotism in our country. We will encourage hard work and give equal opportunities to everyone. We have found it that management problem is also a problem for small and medium enterprises. Entrepreneurship provides a basic energy that moves the present market economy as a new business around the world, encourages competition and economic growth. We are going to try by all means, just as China once did, to use our own local products. And we are going to try by all means to reduce imports, and encourage exports, so using our oil and agriculture. Also, one of the factors that have influenced entrepreneurship is the movie industry known as Nollywood. In this way, we are going to support this movie industry, and it's going to give us income in entrepreneur states. Also, we have also figured out that out of the same half of the youths that are unemployed, over 54% of those youths are female, and in doing so, we have accepted initiatives such as the Ladies in Mechanic Initiative into our country. In doing so, we are encouraging our ladies and our women to join entrepreneurship, because they are being undermined. Another thing that our government is going to do is, because Nigeria holds almost 40% of Africa's population, and we are going to try by all means to produce family planning to reduce growth in the country. Because the more that the country is increasing, and the more unemployment there is, so we are also going to draw on urban areas and villages, because 50% of unemployment grows in urban areas. And we are going to improve our educational sector, and by all means we are going to try and stop the terrorism. With these few points, I rest my case, and I remind you, just as Mahatma Gandhi said, be the change you want to see in the world. Let Africa be the change that we want to see in the world. Thank you.
Okay, so that was a junior president representing the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Up next, ladies and gentlemen, we invite the junior president representing Uganda. Please welcome junior president Alinani Nakazwe. Okay, so that is the junior president for Uganda making her way to the podium. And after her presentation, we have the last remarks from the junior president representing Kenya.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, dignitaries, all protocols observed. I am honored to stand here before you representing a giant nation, Uganda. The topic at hand is entrepreneurship, a substitute for unemployment in Africa. I'll start with the introduction of Uganda. Uganda got its independence in 1962, 9th October, and ever since that time, before her post-independence, she suffered many tragedies, including genocide, and by several sinister leaders. Despite Uganda suffering all these difficult atrocities, despite 8,000 Ugandans killed, prominent politicians, intellects, Uganda has continued to strive in the world as one of the best Africa has ever seen. According to 2012 statistics, Uganda has 12.7 unemployment rate versus a population of over 37 million. This is extremely impressive for an African country. Uganda is also known for its vast mineral resources such as salt, limestone, copper, gold, and it has arable land and also Africa's largest and deepest Lake Victoria. As my government, one of the ways I am going to tackle unemployment in Uganda is building the biggest plantation that Africa has ever seen. My hope is to cooperate with China to build a state-of-the-art facility that will be able to export salt throughout Africa and also worldwide. Secondly, the population consists of mainly women versus men. So that means women are more than men, but men are more educated than women. So what we're doing is giving these women basic reading and writing skills. Uganda has also migrated digitally, and saying this, one of our occupations is computers. So we have realized that IT is becoming one of the leading ways to solve economic problems. We are encouraging young women, young girls, young people to get interested in computer sciences. This has helped Uganda because we have produced the finest women that Africa has ever seen. Coding for Girls, an organization founded by a 28-year-old. This 28-year-old is able to help support many Ugandan girls, educate them about the importance of IT. We also have other intellectuals that have taken up the stand to create employment for themselves. One such an example is a device, an app, a medical app that is able to track fetal heart diseases. And this means that they don't have to go all the time to hospital medical facilities in order to check their heart rates. It was voted amongst African nations as one of the best medical apps ever invented by a young Ugandan. The other thing is that we as Ugandans are discouraging high inputs. We are therefore increasing our tariffs in order to discourage a large number of inputs, and we encourage our Ugandans to export more goods to other neighboring countries. The Ugandan Parliament has also put in place policies and measures that has helped Uganda work with international organizations and also helping Uganda to fight corruption. I'm glad to say Uganda has a very low corruption rate and its unemployment is remarkable, 12.7 versus a population of over 37 million people. As I stated earlier on, the salt implantation that is going to be set up in Uganda will be able to export salt throughout Africa and worldwide. It's creating employment for our youth. The Ugandan youth have refused to remain stagnant. The Ugandan people have refused to lag back in development. The Ugandan youth have taken up this stage, and they have taken up the center stage and refused to wait for the government to start saving them jobs. They have taken up their initiative to create their own jobs through IT, through agriculture, and because the government is allocating land to this youth, they are able to grow coffee, they are able to grow millet, they are able to grow sorghum, they are able to export to other countries. Uganda doesn't need to import goods from other countries. We export goods and we are recognized by other countries such as Denmark and France and Germany. And Uganda is putting a name for itself in the world. In conclusion, I'll quote Nelson Mandela. And he says, life is a wheel. What goes up must come down. What goes down must come up. If we want to move forward as Africa, we should look for other solutions. Rather than formal employment, we can look to entrepreneurship. Thank you so much.
Okay, so there she goes, the junior president representing Uganda. The people from Uganda have got so much to say. Let's now go to our next and final head of state for the summit representing Kenya. Please welcome junior president Perikent Nkole.
Thank you very much. Chairperson of the African Union, His Excellency Joseph Mulenga, fellow African heads of state and governments present, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is with great honor that I stand before you to address this year's African Union Summit under the theme Entrepreneurship, a Substitute for Unemployment in Africa. Since my election as President of Kenya, it's been my priority to provide to the people of Kenya good governance and create a prosperous and globally competitive nation with a high quality of life. Ladies and gentlemen, Kenya is known globally without doubt as the best tourism destination in Africa. And as the president of Kenya, I fully understand the efficacy of entrepreneurship in the tourism industry. The components of a tourism destination comprises a variety of stakeholders nurturing from both compatible and conflicting interests. As such, one important sector which makes significant contributions to the tourism industry is entrepreneurship, which also plays an important role in bringing down unemployment in a country. Unemployment has been one of the major challenges affecting the health of our economy. According to the January 2013 report by the United Nations Development Plan, 80% of Kenya's 2.3 million unemployed people are 15 to 34 years old. About 500,000 youth graduate each year from various tertiary institutions. However, due to factors such as corruption, a larger percentage remains unemployed. During the 2015-2014 budget presentation, my government clearly stated its commitment on building continuous youth support initiatives to further encourage entrepreneurship, innovation, and creativity for the young people. As a government that cares deeply for the youth, who are the greatest resource any nation can ever have, and women whom, if empowered, can contribute mammothly to the development of a country, we are facilitating expansion for credit access so as to afford entrepreneurial opportunities to scale up their small businesses. The WESO Fund, Youth and Enterprise Development Fund, and the Women and Enterprise Fund are various ways through which my government is using to empower women and youth in Kenya. These will be nationalized into an efficient and well-capitalized fund to sustain the ever-growing of our women and youth. I'm pleased to inform the rest of Africa, and indeed all the heads of state present at this summit, that my government recently allocated 300 million Kenyan shillings for the already established and 6 billion Kenyan shillings for WESO Fund. These development funds were set up by my government to empower women and youth in Kenya. Through youth empowerment and innovation, Kenya has been able to improve the health of its economy. As you may be aware, Kenya's economy is market-based with a few state-owned infrastructure enterprises and maintains a liberalized external system. My country is generally perceived as Eastern and Central Africa's hub for financial, communication, and transport services. And compared to its neighbors, Kenya has a well-developed social and physical infrastructure. The Vision 2030, which was established in 2007, has been Kenya's blueprint for the future of economic growth. This is an economic program which aims to put Kenya in the same league as the Asian economic tigers by the year 2030. Long-term goals of this vision are to create a prosperous and globally competitive nation with high quality of life by the year 2030. To do this, it aims to transform Kenyan industry, all the while creating a clean and secure environment. The vision is separated into three different pillars. The economic pillar, which of course aims to improving Kenya's economy and putting it in the same league or even better than the Asian economic tigers by the year 2030. The social pillar, which aims at improving the lives of all Kenyans by targeting human and social welfare programs, specifically education and training, health, environment, housing and urbanization, children and social development, and youth and sports. My fellow excellencies, and lastly, the political pillar, whose main objective is to move to the future and envisions a democratic system that is issue-based, people-centered, result-oriented, and is accountable to the public. The political pillar targets five main areas: the rule of law, which is the constitution of Kenya, electoral and political processes, democracy and public service delivery, transparency and accountability, and security, peace building and conflict management. However, despite having one of the fastest growing economies in Africa, Kenya faces a huge challenge of corruption, which has had a negative effect on the health of our economy. And despite being the world's 47th largest country with an approximate population of 45 million people, poverty eradication still remains one of the major challenges that my country is facing, because 23% of Kenyans are still living on less than a dollar a day. Fellow excellencies, for the past few years, tourism has been Kenya's largest foreign exchange earning sector, followed by agriculture, which is the second largest contributor to Kenya's gross domestic product, GDP. As you may be aware, my country is usually classified as a frontier market, or occasionally as an emerging market, and our economy has seen much expansion by strong performance in tourism, higher education, telecommunication, and agriculture, especially the vital tea sector. As a member of the East African community, Kenya, together with other member states, whom some are present at this summit, like Tanzania, we are hoping to boost regional trade and commerce. The trade bloc aims to work towards economic policies that are pro-market, pro-private sector, and pro-liberalization. Though significant progress has been made in the bloc's integration progress, the customs union and the common market are yet to be fully operational. According to the East African community, Kenya is the most industrialized country in East and Central Africa. And the Nairobi Security Exchange is ranked fourth in Africa in terms of market capitalization. Ladies and gentlemen, I can go on and talk about various economic programs that my government is willing providing to empower our youth and our women, and indeed talk about various entrepreneurship programs that we have. But I see it as important for me to address this issue because of the sentimental attachment I have towards it. I strongly believe that education is not only a right, but a vehicle with which one can use to escape the cycle of poverty. And yet, our children are deprived of not only the right to education, but also the right to life by those who wish to divide us. As you may be aware, a few weeks ago, part of Kenya's greatest resource was taken away, the youth. Same youth who would have transformed Kenyan industry from grass to grace. The same youth who would have benefited from various entrepreneurship programs that my government is providing. The same youth who would have continued the Vision 2030 and moved our nation forward. The same youth who would have been presidents, lawyers, doctors, great innovators, and even entrepreneurs. Nelson Mandela once said that there can be no keener revelation of a society's soul than the way it treats its children, and that the future and hope of a nation is seen in the eyes of its children. But surely, fellow African heads of states, if our children are deprived of the right to survival and development, and if our children are learning in fear, then indeed we have a big problem that needs serious attention. The fight that we are fighting is not a fight against Christians and Muslims. It is not a fight against ethnic groups. It is a fight against good and evil. My mother once told me a story of an African grandfather who sits outside his compound looking sad. His grandson then asked him the question, "How are you feeling, grandfather?" He responded, "I feel as though there are two wolves fighting in my heart. One is the vengeance, violent one. The other is the loving, compassionate, and peaceful one." And then the grandson went further to ask the question, "Which wolf will win the fight in your heart, grandfather?" The old man gave the wisest words any elderly person can ever give. He said, "The wolf that will win the fight in my heart is the one I feed." Ladies and gentlemen, we learn from this story above all else that as Africa, as Kenya, we have the power to create within and around us good or evil. So I ask the question to all the member states or to all the heads of states present at this summit, which wolf are you feeding in your country? Is it the violent one or the peaceful one? As a president who cares deeply for the well-being of his people, I choose the latter. The fight against terrorism can only be won if we work together as a continent. Ladies and gentlemen, I advise each and every head of state present at this summit to preach peace and development in their countries to further protect our future. Ladies and gentlemen, as I conclude, I would like to say that my government, as the President of Kenya, as the proud President of Kenya, I'm committed towards promoting peace and development in my country, and I've even gone further as to take it upon myself to chair a committee which will be called the African Community for Peace and Development, which will be discussed later on during the summit. This will be aimed at promoting peace and development in Africa, and it will not be an optional protocol. It will be mandated by every head of state present at this summit. I am committed towards the improving of the health of Kenya's economy, and indeed use entrepreneurship as an immediate short-term weapon to bring down unemployment in my country. Thank you, and God bless Africa. Or my people would say, Mungu abariki inchi Africa, Mungu abariki wantu Africa. I thank you all.
Okay, so a proud junior president does go back to his seat representing Kenya. That was our final speaker on the theme of the summit, Entrepreneurship, a Substitute for Unemployment on the African Continent. There he is, taking his seat, our final speaker on this subject. Very briefly, we're going to give a chance to each and every one of our junior presidents to tell us what they feel is a lasting solution to insurgencies on the African continent, paying special attention to what's happening in Nigeria and the attacks going on the country which is in Kenya. I'll start with the chairman from Zimbabwe. We'll give you 90 seconds to tell us what you feel is a solution to the challenge that is faced in Africa, especially with the issues of terrorism. You have 90 seconds, Mr. President.
Thank you. The often repeated mantra is that economic development is antidote to violent extremism. In Nigeria and Kenya, they have these Boko Haram and Al-Shabaab militant groups that are fighting against the government. But instead, by the government using military force, they are killing the innocent people. So I believe that these terrorist groups are to be addressed as a political issue. It is a social issue. It is an economic issue. Until these issues are addressed, military groups will not be destroyed. Thank you.
Okay, so those were the remarks from the chairman from Zimbabwe. At this point, we'll move on to the president representing Uganda.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. Violence is defined as inner anger. The inability to maintain peace. Believing that one's views are greater than the other. What is happening in Africa is saddening. Terrorism, innocent children being killed, mothers and fathers displaced. We commonly ask ourselves this question, would this terror ever end? Well, it can only be ended once we know, as the African people, we decide to unite. Instead of killing each other, there should be unity. We should realize that our continent was once considered dark. Would this darkness continue to grow even in this century? We should decide as African leaders to unite our people, to speak peace, and to speak against those who want to bring violence, those people who want to bring down our countries because they feel that they have the ability to suppress other people's rights. And yes, terrorism can be ended. As long as African leaders cooperate with one another and the people know that there should be unity amongst them. These rebel groups only have power only when you give them power. Once you disable their power and unite as Africa, terrorism will be a story of the past. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam President. Next, we get insights from the junior president representing Tanzania.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson, fellow heads of state. It is very sad to note that terrorism is not just a problem that is facing Africa. It is a world problem that has come to light as years are growing. Ladies and gentlemen, the most vital way of preventing terrorism or reducing it is by dialogue. Since we have all known that the method that these terrorists are using is physical, the best way of us conquering them is by going with a method that mostly depends on the mindset. When we dialogue with them, we make them see the bad effects of terrorism. When we dialogue with them, we make them see the beauty of our African children that go to school live for. Then they might stop killing our children. Boko Haram, ladies and gentlemen, has got reasons why they do these acts. They just don't dream and wake up and do them. But if we dialogue with them, we'll make them understand that there are better ways and means of us coming up with one common good. The other thing that can be a solution to this is by us making sure that we advance our security system. Boko Haram does not use in mechanical weapons. It used very advanced weapons that are rarely found in the world. If we can if we can track down these weapons and their origins, then we can limit the supply of these weapons and control their entrance to Africa, hence cutting down the supply of manpower in Boko Haram and weakening its force. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now let's move on to the junior president for South Africa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. Terrorism can be stopped by having discussions and making agreements in order to solve the conflicts. We can take the issue to the social media so that the terrorists themselves can see the bad effects of killing innocent people.
Okay, thank you very much. Very brief and straight to the point. Let's now go to the country that's actually suffering from these attacks. Ladies and gentlemen, the junior president representing Nigeria.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. Nigeria has been faced with the problem of Boko Haram from about 2002. Since then, Boko Haram has been terrorizing our citizens of Nigeria. It is therefore very important that this has to stop, because it does not only have an effect on people's lives, but also on the economic growth of Africa. Terrorism is a way of people trying to get what they want, but it is the worst way in which they have to do it. The best way we can overcome terrorism is by involving people and letting them know about what is right and what is wrong. It is by telling people and letting them know about their rights. It is by improving our infrastructure in each country and improving security. It is by avoiding importing goods that are mysterious and very dangerous. It is by reducing surveillance on your country so that not much can be known out there about your country, whereby you will reduce terrorism. Terrorism has affected so many children and youths around the world. It has affected mothers and fathers. It has affected families in the whole. It has affected countries. And if we come together as heads of state of Africa, we can eradicate terrorism. It is a big problem for Africa right now. Even wars will be created. But it is also good to fight for what's right. It is good to fight against terrorism. I know blood can be shed, but fighting is the best option to fight to eradicate terrorism. Not that violence is good, but fighting back would do. This is all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam President. Kindly turn off your microphone. And now we move on to the junior president representing Namibia.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson. I'd like to say, first of all, that terrorism is an issue that needs to be stopped as soon as possible. And one of the ways we can do this, of course, like the president of Tanzania said, is to strengthen the security of our country, which I think we are all trying to do as at right now. And I think the second thing we need to do is to try and stop religious extremism. Because if you look at these terrorist groups, Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab, all of these emerge partly because of religion. So we need to try and stop religious extremism, and we need to make sure that we create an environment in which people are able to tolerate each other's views when it comes to religion. Look at countries like Zambia. My country, Namibia, these are peaceful countries, although largely Christian, but people are able to tolerate each other's religion, and I think that's the environment that we need to create if we are to stop terrorism. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam President. Now we turn our attention to the delegates on my right. We're going to start with the junior president for Botswana.
As I was saying earlier, it breaks my heart and tears my emotions apart, as we have seen that terrorism has become rampant in Africa. In April 2014, 276 girls were abducted, and up to now, we have not found them. The Bring Back Our Girls campaign has slowly died, and it seems like we're doing nothing. But what can be done to solve this problem? We can engage in a peaceful dialogue with the terrorists, the Al-Shabaab and the Boko Haram people. I'm sure they also have hearts, and when we talk to them peacefully, I'm sure they can understand and get what we're saying. We can also stiffen the laws on how firearms should come into the country and indeed go out of the country. If we do this, I believe we can win the fight against terrorism.
Thank you very much, Madam President. Now we move on to the junior president representing the Democratic Republic of Congo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson. Terrorism is an issue that is affecting Africa very much. And for us to make sure that we combat terrorism in Africa, we should unite as one nation, come together as one people. Because terrorism is an issue that can spread from different countries and even come to our countries where we are. Right now, terrorism is affecting countries like Nigeria and Kenya. But it can also spread to other countries, such as Cameroon, that are very close to Nigeria or Kenya. Now, if we have to stop this terrorism, we must make sure that we see to it that we put up an investigation team that will find out how are these people receiving their funding for them to get their guns. Where are they getting their guns? Or how do they come to find where to find their guns? So if we make sure that we investigate on those issues, we'll see to it that terrorism in Africa will surely stop. And we should even have dialogues with people like Boko Haram, just like my fellow delegate said here, that in Africa, I believe those people also have hearts. So if we talk to them, we call them to meetings, we talk to them, we can see to it that terrorism in Africa can be stopped. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So that was the junior head of state representing the Democratic Republic of Congo. Now we move on to the junior president representing Ghana.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson. The issue of terrorism is one of the biggest issues here in Africa, even in the world. You know, we've got groups like the Taliban, the Jihad, the ISIL, the Al-Qaeda, and the Al-Shabaab, and the Boko Harams. But most especially in Africa, we're looking at Nigeria, whereby Boko Haram is in Nigeria, and Al-Shabaab, which is in Kenya. We can fight these guys by uniting ourselves. We know that we are not fully united as Africans, because recently, when I just arrived here in Zambia, I heard that there's an oil issue. And in my country, we're the second largest producers of crude oil. Therefore, there hasn't been any bilateral agreements with Zambia and my country. Therefore, there is lack of unity among ourselves. If we unite ourselves as Africans, one thing that we need to know is that this, if Boko Haram is not in Nigeria, then he is in another country. He is in another African country. So by uniting ourselves, we'll fight Boko Haram. Another thing is by stiffening the laws in our borders. Because if security is not stiffening in our borders, therefore Boko Haram will always be on the rampant, even Al-Qaeda, even Al-Shabaab. Therefore, another thing is that what we need to do is by training our militaries. We know that most of our militaries only train for some months, years, and we know that our militaries don't have enough equipment to fight these guys. As my previous friend said, we are lacking equipment, and Boko Haram has good high-tech equipment. And even High Excellency said the Saudi Arabian part is the one which is funding Boko Haram.
Mr. President?
In my conclusion, I'll just say, we can defeat Boko Haram if we unite ourselves as Africans, because one Africa, one people, one black African continent. Thank you.
Kindly turn off your microphone, Mr. President. Thank you so much. Now we turn our attention to our next junior head of state representing Kenya.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson. Terrorism is a war against civilization. It says no to development and success and peace, and affirms violence and killing of innocent children. So we have a problem in Africa, terrorism. What can we do about it as heads of state? First of all, problem identification is very important. We've seen the numbers of killings. Like from my country, it is very devastating. I'm wearing a black tie. We're still mourning our youth who were like killed. And it is sad that they are targeting young people, the future and hope that we have. So here's the solution. Those people, they come in and t- take away our pride and they kill our young people. What are we doing about it? Talking about it in the news and everything, that's not enough. First of all, the international community on the cycle of responsibility can only go to a certain extent. Organizations such as the United Nations, for example, can only work at a certain extent in ensuring that they promote peace in the world. If the constitution of a land does not protect people from terrorism, nothing will. Stiffening our policies in the judicial system is very important. People have to be protected, not complaining about it all the time. My government is doing everything possible to ensure that action is taken. And before we know it, if we continue talking about it, nothing will be done. So my government will stiffen the laws in the judicial system, and I advise each and every African head of state present at this summit to make sure that their constitution, which is the supreme law of the land in a republic state, protects their people from terrorism. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Now we move on to the junior head of state representing the Republic of Malawi.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson. Terrorism is one of the challenges that Africa is facing as of now, especially in countries such as Nigeria and Kenya, where we have terrorist groups such as Boko Haram, Al-Qaeda, and Al-Shabaab. But we need to understand that where are these people getting their equipment? Who is sponsoring these people? We cannot find a solution to this if we don't know the grassroots, where everything is coming from. In addition, we need to bring on board other international organizations such as the UN and other trade treaties such as COMESA, SADC, and the PTA to help us to fight Boko Haram. Boko Haram itself in Nigeria, it has many equipments. So I would rather advise each and every delegate that is here representing country to stiffen the security in their country and rather train the military forces that are in their country. Let us do the planning, because thinking of a plan is nothing, but planning is everything. And unity is the key to everything. As the saying goes, united we stand, divided we fall. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Madam President. Next is our final head of state representing Mozambique.
After we see that this has happened, that's when we want to go in. Let's, there and then, if they attack, let's respond. We respond by knowing where they are taking those girls. We need to follow. Not always when they attack, we just say, no, let's wait. What are we waiting for? Let's attack. If they attack us, we attack back. That's the only solution, because we cannot reason with these terrorists. They don't reason. They are very difficult people to reason with. Tell me, for how many years has been Al-Qaeda?
On the next episode of Junior President.
They are trying to reason with them, but you can't reason with terrorists. We just need to attack back. And as the president of Mozambique, I would like to say I heard soldiers complaining about, no, we don't have equipment in Nigeria to fight back. They are going there without equipment. We will provide equipment and I'll provide soldiers to go there and fight back. We need to fight back. That's the only solution, if we fight back.
Okay, so thank you very much, Mr. President. Kindly turn off your microphone. So the junior head of state for Mozambique suggests that Africa must respond to terrorism. This has been the Junior President AU Summit, and we're going to take a short break, and then after that, our judges are going to tell us which two have been our best performers for the summit so far, and which three are up for elimination from the competition. Just after this, in the next 5 minutes, our judges will be giving us that announcement.
Get a life, get a gig with Samtel's new permanent bundle. You heard right, your internet dreams have come true. For only 49 kwacha, you get 7 days of 1 gigabyte data. Internet heaven is now permanent and is here to stay 4G. 49 kwacha for 1 gigabyte all week to download, upload, connect, update, share, stream, broadcast, and just, well, internet. All day, every day for 7 days. So what are you waiting for? Get a life, get a gig today. Zamtel, live life today.
Thank you very much for still staying with us. In case you just joined us, you have been watching pictures of the Junior President AU Summit, the first assignment in a series of many yet to come. 12 different heads of state spoke on our theme, Entrepreneurship, a Substitute for Unemployment on the African Continent. And later on, they engaged in a deliberation on the Boko Haram and other insurgencies that are prevailing on the African continent. At this point, our judges are ready to tell us which two were the best performers in the summit and which three were in the bottom and up for elimination. At this point, I will call upon Madam Sylvia Bwalya Mwansa to just give us those results. Please, Madam, go ahead.
Thank you very much. It was very hard. They have really studied and they've done their research quite well. And we can see that, they know something about what they're talking about, and especially entrepreneurship. And we also saw that they've advised what policies they should put in place so that entrepreneurship can work in the countries that they represented. So I think at this stage they are all winners, but they have to be the first and the last. So we identified the two winners to be coming from Congo and Kenya.
Okay, so those are the two best performers for the Junior President AU Summit.
And despite them really having their facts at hand, we've got the last three, which is coming from Mozambique.
And Mozambique, please stand.
Uganda.
Uganda, please stand.
And RSA, South Africa.
And the Republic of South Africa, please stand.
You're not losers, you know your facts. It's only that you need to research more and be confident and not lose the things that are giving you points. You did very well. It's only in those areas.
Thank you very much, Madam, and kindly help us turn off your microphone. Okay, so those three, please keep standing. Those three from the Republic of Mozambique, from the Republic of South Africa, and from the Republic of Uganda are up for elimination on the program. So to you, our viewers from home, you can save only one person. Two of them must leave the competition. Voting lines officially do open. Vote for the one that you feel should remain in the competition. Vote for the person you feel should remain in the competition. And that one person only is going to remain on Junior President. The two must leave the competition. Will it be Mozambique? Will it be the Republic of South Africa or Uganda? Is it going to be Mputa Ngalande? Is it going to be Christine Mubanga? Or is it going to be Ali Nani Nakazwe? Out of all this, you can only save one person. The person with the most votes remains in the competition. Until our next edition, remember that these voting lines will close very soon, so get on it. Those are the voting patterns for each and every one individual. Those are the voting rules. Vote for your favorite candidate that you feel deserves a place on the competition. It's nothing personal, but it's very personal. When you're good, you're good. Until our next edition, wonderful things are coming. Wonderful things.